with me to the third chapter, beginning at verse 3 of 2 Peter. Knowing this first, that there shall come in the last days. Now notice that expression, the last days. You'll find it many times in the Bible. The Bible says that there is going to be an X point in history that will be known as the latter days or the last days. Many people think that we are in that period now. Nobody knows for sure. The Bible warns us against speculating on times and seasons and dates. But there is a period of time taught in the Bible that is called the last days. And then the next word is scoffers. Scoffers will come in the last days. Cynics. People will say, oh yeah, God is dead. We can't find God anywhere. We took a trip up in space. We didn't meet God. We didn't meet the angels while we were up there. And there are going to be other scoffers that will scoff at the idea of future judgment, scoff at the idea that Jesus Christ is coming back to this earth again. They'll laugh at the whole idea. Why? The next phrase tells us, walking after their own lust. They don't want Christ to come. They don't want Christ to come and interfere with their way of living. They love their lust. They love their sins so much that they don't want Christ coming, and they cannot accept the idea that God is a God of judgment. Now, we know that God is a God of love. We know that God is a God of mercy. But the Bible also teaches that God is a God of wrath. He's a God of anger. Now, that's not an emotional anger like you and I have. That's an eternal anger at evil. A righteous indignation that Jesus had when he went into the temple and drove out the money changers. The righteous indignation that he had when he turned on the Pharisees and call them all kinds of names in the 23rd chapter of Matthew. But primarily, he accused them of being hypocrites. Scoffers walking after their own lust. And then the scripture says, for this they willingly are ignorant of, that by the word of God the heavens were of old, and the earth standing out of the water and in the water, whereby the world that then was, being overflowed with water, perished. But the heavens and the earth, which are now, right now, by the same word, are kept in store, reserved unto fire, against the day of judgment and perdition of ungodly men. But, beloved, be not ignorant of this one thing, that one day is with the Lord 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is one day. The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. But remember this, the day of the Lord is going to come like a thief in the night, in which the heavens will pass away with a great noise, and the elements will melt with fervent heat, and the earth also and the works that are therein shall be burned up. Now in this passage of scripture, the Apostle Peter, under the inspiration much preaching about. And you know, the preachers today of judgment and Armageddon are the scientists. Our scientists are doing the preaching. We in the pulpit are silent on the subject, and the Bible is filled with it. We ought to be teaching the people and preaching to the people, warning the people, showing the people the way of salvation. Now, in the midst of that generation of that day, there lived a man who believed in God. He walked with God. God said, the thing has become so bad and so decadent and so violent, I'm going to destroy the human race and I'm going to start over again. Because you see, when God created man, he gave him a gift he didn't give to his other creatures. He created man in his image and gave him freedom of choice. Man took this freedom and it became license. He went his own way, rebelled against God, began to live his own life, and God said, if you rebel against me, you're going to die. Man has been suffering and dying ever since. It's now appointed unto man once to die, and after that, the judgment, because of our rebellion. Sin is rebellion against God. We're all rebels. The Bible says all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. We're all under the sentence of death. We're all under God's sentence. The wages of sin is death. But in the midst of the generation of that day, there lived a man, one man, that believed in God. His name was Noah. We've got some people today that believe in God. There are people all over this world, in every country and every city of the world, from Moscow to Peking, that believe in God. They may have to do it secretly, but they believe. When Miss Stalin came to this country, the daughter of Joseph Stalin, she had been reared in intellectual atheism. She said, I could no longer live in a world in which there was no God. And she said, all through the Soviet Union, there are believers. She said, even in the Communist Party, there are believers. You see, there are people who may declare their atheism, but down inside have a secret faith and a secret belief that God is. Noah believed in God in the midst of that crooked and perverse generation, and he dared to stand alone. He dared to stand up and say, I believe, in a period when the whole trend was against any faith at all. And I want to tell you, to stand up at one of our modern universities today and say, I believe in God, and lift up a Bible and say, I believe this book to be the inspired word of God, takes a lot of courage. And there's many a professor that leads a lonely life on campus, a Christian professor. There's a many a student in a class that leads a lonely life because he believes in Christ and he believes in God and he believes in the Bible. But they're there. God has his people scattered all over the world. And a crusade like this brings a lot of them together. And a lot of you are going to go back and you're going to have to fight 1,000 battles with yourself and with others. He dared to stand alone. And that's what Jesus meant when he said, take up the cross and follow me. Bear my reproach. Be willing to go outside the camp with me and live where it's unpopular. Are you willing to do that? He said, count the cost. You may have to stand alone. Noah stood alone, and God came to him one day, and God said, Noah, I'm going to destroy the human race with a flood. I'm going to cause it to rain 40 days and 40 nights, and I want you to build a ship and save your household and save the animals. And the Bible says that Noah believed God. Noah didn't argue with God and say, well, Lord, there's no scientific evidence that any flood's coming. I haven't heard Walter Cronkite mention it on the news yet. I haven't heard any scientist say anything about it at Columbia or Stanford. The Bible says, by faith, Noah, being warned of God of things not seen as yet. No evidence. As yet. Not seen as yet. Moved with fear. Notice what moved him. Fear. Prepared the ark. generation had a right to be moved by fear and get right with God, it's our generation. That headline.